Okay, so many of you are here. In fact, we're all here right now, really, to hear Dr. Jason Lisle talk about cosmology, the evolutionary model and problems. So Dr. Jason Lisle is first of all, I have to let you know that as I was researching him on the internet, I did a Google search, and I discovered that he was apparently born in 1950, which would mean that it took him about 30 years to graduate high school. So, there we go, time dilation, yes. You may want to take that. So Dr. Lisle is a Christian astrophysicist who researches issues pertaining to science and the Christian faith. He double majored in physics and astronomy with a minor in mathematics at Ohio Wesleyan University. He then went on to obtain a master's degree and PhD in astrophysics at the University of Colorado in Boulder, which is a tough place to leave. It's a wonderful, one of the nicer places on the planet. There he used the SOHO spacecraft to analyze the surface of the sun, made a number of interesting discoveries, including the detection of giant cell boundaries. Since then, he's worked in full-time apologetics ministry. He wrote a number of planetarium shows for the Creation Museum, including the popular Created Cosmos. He's authored a number of best-selling books on the topic of creation, and he's also recently established the Biblical Science Institute. Now, you can find, and his team is just around the corner in the other room. In fact, while we're discussing that, please make sure that, because oftentimes they've been out of sight, but I want to make sure that you go and visit all of the exhibitors over there. But the Biblical Science Institute is just around the corner there. So with that, please extend a warm Pittsburgh welcome to Dr. Jason Lisle. Are you willing to do questions? Do you want to do questions? Okay, sorry about that. One last thing is when we get done, questions will be taken here at the microphone in front.
There we go. What's better? What's not better? I am very honored to be with you this evening. I am Dr. Lisle. I'm with the Biblical Science Institute. That is a brand new ministry. We're just 1 year old as of a couple weeks ago. So I'm no longer with AIG or ICR. I'm happy to work with those fine ministries, but I wanted to try some new things and step out in faith, and the Lord's been faithful, and it's very exciting. I'm very honored to be here and present to you this evening. I want to thank the board for inviting me out here to speak on the topic of cosmology, evolutionary model, and problems. And so I'm going to talk about what the secularists believe in terms of their model of the universe, how it came to be the way that it is today, a topic of cosmology, the study of the structure of the universe and how it changes over time. And my contention is that Christians should reject the standard secular cosmological model for 5 reasons that I'm going to elaborate on this evening. And the standard cosmological model, you've probably heard of that, that's the Big Bang, sometimes called the Big Bang Theory. I think that's overly generous. I don't think it should be called a theory, because the theory has some supporting evidence, has passed certain standards. The Big Bang hasn't. The standard model, a lot of times, is what the secularists will call that. But standard model can also refer to the standard model of particle physics, which I happen to think is pretty good. I think that's something that at least is on the right track. But I believe the standard cosmological model, which is secular, is flawed for a number of reasons, not just the least of which is it's secular, right? It's based on the premise that you can account for the universe the way it is today without God. And I don't believe that. As a consistent Christian, I don't believe that's possible. There are 5 reasons I'm going to list this evening for why we ought to reject the standard cosmological model. First of all, it's not good science. And that's sort of ironic, because people think, well, that's the scientific model for how the universe began, right? We're going to see it really isn't good science. It's not compatible with the Bible. That's the most important reason, of course, that I've found, that because people have so little respect for the Bible these days, unfortunately, sometimes you have to knock out the and show them that it's not good science first as a matter of strategy that might be useful to you. But it's not compatible with the Bible. There is scientific evidence, specific lines of scientific evidence that would challenge the standard cosmological model, those lines that would seem to be inconsistent with it. Fourth, there are observations that are consistent with a young universe, whereas the standard cosmological model requires billions and billions of years. And then finally, biblical creation is actually the foundation for science. So if science is a successful endeavor for testing certain truth claims, then the Bible has to be true, and that means biblical creation, and that means not the standard secular cosmological model. And so to explore these, I need to kind of summarize what the standard cosmological model is. And so we came to a creation conference, and we're going to hear about the Big Bang, about that. But then we're going to see the problems with it. So this is sort of my summary. It's a very concise summary. I'm not claiming to go into every detail. We'll get some of the details later on. But basically, this is the standard cosmological model. The entire universe is contained initially in a point that they call a singularity. Now, there are different types of singularities in physics. This is one type in which all the energy and matter and space itself are collected into what we might think of as a zero-dimensional entity, a point, something that has no signs, a singularity. And then, there's a misconception here because some people think, well, this is a point in space, it's surrounded by empty space. All the mass of the universe is collected into a point surrounded by empty space. But actually, it's not even surrounded by empty space because even space is in the singularity, okay? And that seems a little bit weird, but it's not my model. So, anyway. By the way, there are other types of singularities that are surrounded by space, and I think some of those might actually be real. But in any case, this point then rapidly expands like a balloon. So it goes into a three-dimensional space, which expands. Now, there's a lot of misconception on this, because this is an analogy. And the surface of the balloon, which is two-dimensional, because it has height and length, but not really any substantial depth to it, right? I mean, a little bit, but not much. That two-dimensional surface is supposed to represent the three dimensions of our universe, the three dimensions of space, okay? And so just as an ant on a balloon could walk all the way around it and come back to the starting point, in some models, in some versions of the standard model, in three-dimensional space, you can go straight out and yet eventually come back to where you started because it's wrapped around it. You can think of it as being wrapped around a fourth spatial dimension. Most physicists don't think of it that way, but if that helps you to conceptualize it, that's fine. You can embed it in an artificial dimension that way. So as it expands, then all the energy that is contained in everything that will become everything, that expands as well. And it cools. Because that just follows from the ideal gas law, because you have the pressure dropping tremendously and the volumes increase, the temperature's going to drop as well as it expands. Initially, at this point, there's no actual matter in the universe. We don't have things like atoms of hydrogen or things like that. Certainly not the heavier atoms. It's electromagnetic radiation, a lot of that, and you'll have subatomic particles that pop into existence and pop out of existence from the substructure of space. Now, as it expands, it cools, and that energy cools to the point where it can become matter. And so some of that energy, some of it, is transformed into the two lightest elements, hydrogen and helium, which are both gases, and just a little bit of lithium, the third lightest element, and their various stable isotopes, but unstable ones too, but then they decay. It doesn't make any of the heavier elements, only the lightest three. Elements number 1, 2, and 3 on the periodic table are supposed to have been formed by the energy from that initial Big Bang, from that initial as the energy cools, and we'll take a look at that a little bit later on and some of the issues there. But of course, at some point, you got to make the heavier elements, so that's going to be an issue. How do you do that? Well, you're going to do it with stars, because the next step is some of that hydrogen and helium collapses it into stars. By the way, some of the energy remains energy, and it continues to stream out into space, and they think that's what makes the cosmic microwave background, which we'll talk about later. Some of it forms hydrogen and helium gas. Some of that just remains gas, and you'll see we find these enormous nebulae out in space, large clouds of hydrogen and helium gas. But some of those clouds supposedly have condensed into stars. Under the force of gravity, it's supposed to pull them together into stars, and the stars collect into galaxies. And there's been some debate over the decades as to whether the galaxies form in the stars, or whether the stars form first and then collect into galaxies. And in any case, there are slightly different versions of the standard model, but I'm just giving you sort of the nuts and bolts, the basics of it. Now, those stars then create heavier elements. The idea is that in the core of stars, you've got fusion going on, And actually, I think there's good evidence that stars like the Sun fuse hydrogen into helium, like a big nuclear bomb, so to speak, although the actual rate isn't as much as people think. But because the temperature in the core of the Sun is so great and the pressure is so great, you can actually ram protons together, and through a process of proton-proton chain, you get helium from that. So helium is the byproduct. Of course, that you've already got helium in the universe, so that doesn't help you very much. But the idea is that some stars, when they then run out of hydrogen in their core, will begin fusing helium, which requires a different, you know, pressure, higher pressure and temperature, but the star is supposed to collapse in a little bit, and then it initiates the helium flash, and then it starts fusing helium, and then it starts fusing the next element. When it runs out of helium, it fuses the next element, and the next element, and the next element, so on. So you can get heavier and heavier elements, up to iron. And you can't do anything heavier than iron, because reactions after iron are endothermic. It would actually, they don't release energy, they absorb energy. And so you can't power a star that way, okay? You can't, you know, release energy by losing a little bit in every step. That's not going to work. But the idea is that some stars are so massive that at the very end of their life, when they've fused all the fusible material up to iron, there's this implosion that, even though the reaction is endothermic, it produces chains of these higher elements all the way up to uranium, for example. And so it's only in a supernova, as an exploding star, that secondary astronomers believe you can form the elements heavier than iron. And so that is supposed to account for all the rest of the elements on the periodic table, which is a lot of them, right? But it's kind of interesting to me that, you know, the actual Big Bang, the initial expansion there, only forms three elements. And there are what? There are around 90 naturally occurring elements in the universe. The Big Bang accounts for three of them. And then they have to explain the other almost 90 by stellar nucleosynthesis, and in particular, just the supernova reaction to get the really heavy stuff. The idea is that some of that then gets blasted out in space as dust. Dust is made up of heavier stuff heavier than hydrogen and helium. And then the idea is that some of that dust, some of it remains in space, some of it condenses and forms planets like the Earth, and so on. You can even form the core of the gas giants, and then they can collect hydrogen in their envelopes there. And so this is the model that explains the universe as it is today, because we do have heavier elements today, right? We have elements all the way up to uranium, and, well, okay, they're made in supernova. Okay, well, we have hydrogen and gas. How do you get that? What's made from that initial energy? Okay, the universe seems to be expanding. Well, yeah, that's because it started that way. And we have planets. Well, they formed from the dust. And so it does account for the universe that we have today. But my question is, which of these steps are scientific in the sense that they are observable and repeatable in the present? Let's think about that, because we're told that this is the scientific version of origins, right? And you crazy creationists, you know, you believe in all this silly magic and everything. This is the science version, right? Well, science, in an operational sense, is always about testability and repeatability. You learn that in high school. You learn about, you know, you have to do an experiment that can falsify your hypothesis and so on. Which of these have been repeated in the laboratory or have been observed in the actual universe? Have we in a laboratory, contracted a universe into a point? Well, no. We've never seen a universe that is zero-dimensional, and I'm not sure how we would anyway. But that would seem to be a bit problematic. It's certainly not something that we've observed. We have not observed that a universe can be a point. It's not science. A point rapidly expanding like a balloon. Well, I do think there's evidence that the universe is being stretched out, or at least has been stretched out. I think that's even biblical. But in terms of being stretched from a point, we have not seen that. No one has seen space-time being stretched from a zero-dimensional structure to a three-dimensional structure, three dimensions of space, one of time, right? We've not seen that. It's not observed. You can't repeat that in a laboratory. How about energy becoming matter? Can we take energy and make matter from it? And the answer is actually, yes, we can. This is something that we can do in particle accelerators. We can take particles and slam them together at very high speeds, and some of their kinetic energy will manifest as new particles. Pretty neat. So you'd say, well, there you go. That step's confirmed. Not really, because the claim is not that energy can be converted into matter. If that were the claim, it would be verified. We can do that. The claim is that all the matter in the universe was produced that way. That's a different claim, isn't it? It's one thing for me to say, your freezer can turn water into ice, which it can. You can verify that scientifically. It's quite another thing for me to say, all the ice on the Earth was produced in your freezer. See the difference? Energy can become matter. And have we demonstrated that all the matter in the universe was once energy? We haven't demonstrated that. So I'm going to call that plausible, but it's certainly not. It hasn't been verified scientifically. We just know that it's possible scientifically. With a caveat, we'll see there's some problems with this as we go later on. Have we seen matter being condensed into stars and galaxies? No. I know you've read all, but this is a star-forming region, right? Let me clue you in. No one has seen a star form. No one has seen that observationally in terms of gas that's actually collapsing in on itself. It's measurably collapsing in on itself into a tighter space. We've not seen that. Gas in space is either stable as a star or it's expanding in a nebula. It's not contracting in on itself. We've never seen that. And so it's certainly not something that has been scientifically observed. Now, I'm not saying at this point that it's impossible, but I am saying it has never been observed or demonstrated scientifically. What about, have we observed that stars can make heavier elements? Well, I think there's indirect evidence that you can get hydrogen into helium. I think there's pretty compelling evidence for that. But in terms of making elements heavier than iron in a supernova, that's very questionable. It's certainly not something we've observed. Nobody has observed a supernova that we know enriches the interstellar medium after the explosion. We haven't measured the interstellar medium before and after and find that it's enriched with heavier elements after the explosion. We've not observed that. We've not observed that. In fact, there are some physics problems making some of these heavier elements because of the way their spores are supposed to form. It's challenging in terms of the science there. Have we seen dust condensed to form planets? The answer is no, we've not seen that. In fact, we haven't even been able to really simulate it properly. The simulations show that you can get dust to accumulate into little sort of dust bunnies, but then that's all the bigger they get, because after that, collisions tend to fragment them apart anyway. So not only has that not been observed, we can't even really simulate it. So think about that. I mean, of the six steps in the scientific version of the origin of the universe, five of them have not been observed scientifically at all, and one of them is plausible, but it hasn't really been observed. So I think it's interesting that really no step of the standard cosmological is operational observational science. It just isn't. And some people would say that creation hasn't been scientifically observed either, and I'd say that's true, but creation doesn't claim to be a scientific fact. Creation is an historical fact, one that makes science possible. And so that's in a different category, and we do have good historical evidence for creation, and it happens to line up with the science that we observe today. So, a model in science is a schematic description of a system theory or phenomenon that accounts for its known or inferred properties and may be used for further study of its characteristics. That's the dictionary definition of a model in a scientific sense of the word. Now, the Big Bang does count as a model because it is a schematic description of a system, or theory in this case, the universe, that accounts for its known or inferred properties. It accounts for why the universe has stars, why the universe is made of the atoms that it's made of, primarily hydrogen and helium, and trace amounts of the other stuff. It accounts for why there are planets. I don't think it accounts for them correctly, but it does account for them. And so it counts as a model. It does explain these things. The explanation is wrong, but it's an explanation. And it may be used for further study of the characteristics, indicating that it will make predictions about what you would expect to find in the future. So anything counts as a model. We have various creation models as well. We discussed some of those during the panel discussion. But what makes a good model? A good model is, first of all, relatively simple. And sometimes laymen mess that up. They think, something's got a lot of equations and it looks very complicated, it must be true. But really, it's the reverse. You've heard of Occam's razor. And when you have competing models, the one that has the fewer assumptions tends to be more likely to be it's certainly better, and it tends to be more likely to be true. And nature seems to prefer simplicity. It's because nature's upheld by the mind of God. And there is a simplicity in Christ, the Bible tells us. So the fewer assumptions, the better. Assuming the two models make the same predictions, right? And then, of course, the second characteristic is a good model has to make many correct specific predictions. It needs to make many correct specific predictions. It's not good enough to make one, right? Even a blind squirrel gets an acorn every now and then. That's not impressive. An incorrect model will occasionally make a correct prediction. It needs to make many correct predictions. They need to be correct, of course. If the predictions are wrong, your model's falsified. Yeah, if people really approach it that way, they'll tend to modify their model. Well, you can do that, but then it's a different model, isn't it? And the correction, the predictions need to be specific. The more specific, the better. If I had a model, I said, my model predicts that tomorrow something will happen. And then, lo and behold, tomorrow something happens. And I say, there you go. My model's verified. That's not very specific, is it? Because any model predicts that, or just about any. So it needs to be a specific prediction. Examples of good models would be the heliocentric model for the solar system, the idea that the planets orbit the sun, and Newton's laws of gravity and motion. These are examples of good models in science. The heliocentric solar system is not the only one that's been proposed. There was the geocentric model, which had the planets all orbiting the Earth, and the Ptolemaic system had that. But to get that to work right, in order for it to be consistent with observations, you had to make the planets make little circles as they go around the big circle, right? The little circles, the epicycles that go around the deferent. And that's kind of complicated. But the interesting thing about this is it works. Did you know that? You can make correct predictions using this model. The Ptolemaic model was used for over a millennium because it tended to make pretty good predictions. Copernicus came along and said, let's put the sun at the center. He wasn't the first to come up with that idea, but he revived that idea. And the main advantage of the Copernican model is not that it makes better predictions. Its predictions were about the same as Ptolemy's. Because even he didn't have it quite right. He assumed perfect circles. They're not. They're ellipses. But in any case, the main advantage of the Copernican model is it's simpler. You don't need those epicycles. You can account for retrograde motion naturally as one planet passes another in its orbit. And so that's an example of a good model. Newton's laws of motion and gravity. Those are fantastic because think of how simple those are. You got Newton's three laws of motion and his law of gravity. You can write those on an index card. And from those four principles, you can predict the motion of just about anything in the universe, at least in non-relativistic limits. That's amazing. You can actually explain why planets orbit the way that they do and so on. In fact, Newton's laws were so successful that they predicted the existence of the planet Neptune. The planet Uranus was off in its orbit from where it would be if there were no other objects out there. And two mathematicians independently realized that there must be another planet pulling on it, and they calculated its position. And one of them sent the coordinates into the observatory, and that very night they pointed the telescope. He said, if you point your telescope here, you will see a new planet. And lo and behold, they pointed the telescope there and found Neptune. That's awesome. See, that is a bold prediction. It's a very specific prediction, right? You point your telescope here, you'll see a new planet. And that's bold because most places you point a telescope, you will not see a new planet. Right? I mean, they had the rest of the universe, and Neptune wasn't there. It was right in the spot where they predicted. So that's an example of a good model. It makes many correct specific predictions. And of course, today we can use Newtonian mechanics to predict the positions of the planets into the distant future. It works very, very well. So how does the Big Bang, the standard cosmological model, how does it stack up? Is it relatively simple? Well, I've simplified it into six steps, but really the latest versions are very, very complex, and they have a lot of arbitrary assumptions built into them. There's inflation, there's quintessence, all these different parameters that they've had to add, I think, as band-aids to get the model to line up with observations. So it's really not very simple. Now, I would argue it started out pretty simple. The first version of the Big Bang that LeMaitre produced back in 31, it was relatively simple, but the latest versions are not. They're quite complex. And a lot of arbitrary knobs that you can do to get things to work out right. Does it make many correct specific predictions? And the answer is no. Now I'll give you one, and that's the cosmic microwave background. The Big Bang predicted that there should be microwaves coming from all directions in space. If you could go outside at night, if you could see microwaves, you'd go outside on a clear night and you would see the sky would be aglow with microwaves coming from all directions in space. And that's something that the Big Bang supporters, in fact, predicted, and they were right about that. It sounds impressive until you give it a little bit of thought, and then you think, well, it's not really as good of a prediction as you might have guessed, because they predicted that this would have a characteristic temperature of about 3 degrees above absolute zero, which is within, it's 2.7, that's in the right range. But there was other predictions that were as low as 1 and some as high as 50. And so there was a range of different predictions, and they happened to pick the one that happened to be right. It also predicted that there should be variations in these microwaves, hot spots and cold spots, that are at least 10 times more intense than we actually find. So in other words, the cosmic microwave background is much more uniform than was predicted in the Big Bang model. They've come up with ways to try and account for that. But my point is, it doesn't make many correct specific predictions. It's made one, and it wasn't all that specific, and it wasn't all that correct. So the standard cosmological model is not good science, just on the face of it. It's not compatible with the Bible. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this, because I suspect you know a lot of this, but just because you might need to share this with others, a lot of people think, well, you know, couldn't God have used the Big Bang to create? And the answer is unless he's a liar, because that's not what he says he did in Genesis. You need to understand that the standard cosmological model is naturalistic. It attempts to explain the cause of the universe without God. I have a number of textbooks that describe the standard cosmological model. None of them say God started it. And so this idea that, you know, E. Ross says, well, you see, that shows that God started the universe. I'm afraid that most astrophysicists don't see it that way. They would say it was caused by a quantum fluctuation, or it was caused by nothing, or maybe we can't know. It's not caused by God. It's not a supernatural act of God. But the Bible indicates God spoke the universe into existence. The time scale, we can't sweep that under the rug. The standard cosmological model requires billions of years to get the universe from its initial point to the way it is today, whereas the Bible indicates that the universe is only thousands of years old. It only took 6 days for God to create and get it to the point where it was absolutely perfect. And even there, it's not like he needed that time. He just did it that way as a pattern for us. So that's where we get our seven-day week. The order of events is different. A lot of people think if you can make the days of creation long periods of time, then see, you can let the standard model line up with the Bible. No, you can't, because the standard model has stars forming long before the Earth. And they have to, because remember, the heavy stuff that the Earth's made of is supposed to be produced inside supernovae. So you have to have not only stars, you have to have at least a generation of stars to make some of those heavy elements. And, of course, if you follow the standard cosmological model all the way into models of secular models of Earth formation and such, you find that the secular view is that fish evolved before trees, but the Bible has trees on day 3, fish on day 5. The secular view has dinosaurs evolving before birds, but according to the Bible, birds are created on day 5, dinosaurs are made on day 6. And so the order of events is quite different. The future, you know, the standard cosmological model is not just a story about the past, it's a story about the future, the way the universe will be. In the future, it's supposed to continue to expand, and eventually, due to the second law of thermodynamics, everything runs out of usable energy. It gives up all of its heat, and we call that a heat death, because there's no longer any exchange of thermal energy. Everything's sort of run out of heat. And that's very different from the future that the Bible indicates. The Bible indicates a heat destruction, if you will, and a new heavens and a new earth that will remain perfect forever. It'll be very good, just like the original earth was before sin. So the future is very different. In the standard model, you'd expect life evolves wherever chemistry's right. It's a big universe. Chemistry's probably right out there somewhere. So ETs are likely to be found, whereas, and I'll grant the Bible doesn't say there's not extraterrestrial life out there, but nonetheless, the Bible does indicate that God formed the earth to be inhabited. It's designed for life, and he doesn't say that about the other objects that he created for his glory and to be for signs, seasons, days, and years. The original Earth, according to the standard cosmological model, is molten rock. It's supposed to have collapsed from that nebula and be very warm when it first started. According to the Bible, it's created from water, right? God initially made it as water and then brought the land forth and so on. And by the sixth day, it was a paradise. So it's very, very different. So it's not compatible with the Bible. There's scientific evidence that challenges the standard cosmological model. That's probably why you came. You want to hear that. So without further ado, here's some of the problems. And I'm just going to focus on the problems that are in the secular literature. Now, Big Bang supporters might say, well, we've got an answer for that now. Okay, we can deal with that. But these historically have been problems with the Big Bang, and I think they really still are, to be honest. I think we can solve. You have the flatness problem, the idea that the expansion rate of the universe is very finely balanced with gravity. So expansion tends to make the universe bigger. Gravity tends to want to stop that and make it smaller. And those two things are very, very well balanced, like a pencil standing on its end, on the sharp end. And it turns out when you run the equations backwards, In order to get that flatness today, they would have to be even more flat at the very beginning. They would have to be more finely balanced, which I suppose isn't a problem if you believe in God, if you believe in that God created the universe, you'd expect them to be somewhat balanced even today. But if it's just physics that somehow gave rise to these things, you wouldn't expect that, because any range is allowable. We have the horizon problem. Now, this is interesting because this is a light travel time problem. And the Big Bang supporters like to chide creationists for having a light travel time problem. I think ours is far more resolvable than theirs, because it's not a starlight issue per se, but the idea is that in the Big Bang, when it first starts, when the universe is very small, it's going to have different temperatures in different places, hot spots and cold spots, okay? And then the universe balloons out very rapidly, so now the spots are very far away from each other. And yet today, the temperatures are almost the same everywhere. The cosmic microwave background is very uniform. It does have minor increases and decreases, but the hot spots and cold spots, the really intense ones, are gone, which means the energy from the hot spot must have somehow got to the cold spot, right? It has to exchange energy. You put your ice cube in your hot coffee, you end up with warm coffee eventually, but they have to exchange energy. And the problem is, even if you give them 13.8 billion years, there's not been enough time for light to travel from that hot spot to the cold spot to even out those temperatures. So that's a horizon problem. And he said, well, what if they made the universe older and give you more time? That doesn't work, because then it allows you to see even further into space, you see. No matter how long it takes the light to get from there to here, it's going to take it longer to get from there to there, right? It's going to take longer to go the full distance than halfway. So that's the horizon problem. And then we have the monopole problem. Physics allows for the existence of magnetic monopoles, particles that have a single polarity. Like a magnet is a north and a south. Theoretically, you could have a particle that has only a north magnetic pole or only a south magnetic pole. And they're supposed to be produced at the extremely high temperatures of the Big Bang. But we haven't found any. We haven't found any. And that suggests to me that there was no Big Bang. Because if these things are supposed to be produced in the high temperatures associated with the Big Bang, and we don't find any, that suggests those high temperatures never existed, and therefore there wasn't a Big Bang. Now, those three problems, flatness, horizon, and monopole, my secular colleagues attempt to solve those three problems simultaneously with inflation. So if you've heard of inflationary Big Bang scenarios, that's an attempt to solve those problems. Inflation is an additional set of assumptions in which the universe begins to expand at a much accelerated rate at a certain point in time. So the universe starts expanding at what we'll call the slow rate, which is actually very fast, but it's slow compared to what comes next. And then it jumps into this inflation phase where it really balloons out. And then it somehow switches off and goes back to the slow rate again, which again is very fast. So, I'm not going to go into the details of how it can alleviate this problem, but I'll just say that it can. It can reduce this problem, maybe even eliminate it. But really, the inflation is really just another story without supporting evidence. And it has problems of its own, such as how do you turn it off everywhere at the same time? It's called the graceful exit problem. And these are problems that you can read about in the standard technical literature. But there are more scientific problems with the standard cosmological model that would not be resolved even if inflation were true. The problem of, for example, the singularity. There's actually really three problems. There's the existence of the singularity. I'm not denying that singularities are possible, but usually in physics, when you're solving a physics problem and you get an answer that's infinity, usually it's an indication you messed up somewhere, right? And so that suggests that maybe we ought to go back. I'm not saying it's impossible, but that suggests maybe you've have a problem there. Some versions of it don't even end up in a singularity, which is interesting. The breakdown of thin physics. We have physics that can explain what happens in extreme gravitational fields, and that's general relativity. And we have physics that can explain what happens when you have a very small space, like subatomic scales, and that's called quantum mechanics. But currently, there is no branch of physics that can explain what happens when you have both of those situations. Intense gravity in a very tiny space, which is exactly the conditions that the Big Bang requires. And so my point is, my secular colleagues have to take it on blind faith that if such a physics is ever discovered, it will even allow for a Big Bang. Isn't that interesting? Finally, the cause of the universe. You realize that the Big Bang doesn't actually explain how the singularity got there or why it suddenly started expanding. It's just a story about what supposedly happened afterwards. I think it's ironic. The one thing the Big Bang does not explain is the origin of the universe. Isn't that funny? Because that's what people think it was designed to explain. It's a very odd number problem. I think that this may be my favorite because it's just, it's easy to understand. It's the question of where's the antimatter? Because remember early on we said that the matter, all the matter today, according to the Big Bang, was once energy. And we know that you can take energy and the kinetic energy of particles and turn that into new particles. You can make matter from energy, but every time we do it in the laboratory, we get an equal amount of antimatter. Now, antimatter is the same as ordinary matter, but the charges of the particles are reversed, right? So you've got in normal matter, you've got a positively charged proton. An antimatter particle would have a negatively charged, called an antiproton. And if it was like an antihydrogen, it would have a positron circling it, okay? And so if we make hydrogen, we get an equal amount of antihydrogen, and so on. Every particle we make, you get an antiparticle. Every time we've done it in a laboratory, you get an equal amount. And that seems to be a conserved property. A baryon is just an ordinary particle, like a proton or neutrons are both baryons. Right, and so they're a very ordinary particle. There's a Star Trek The Next Generation episode where they do a baryon sweep, but everyone's worried about these baryons. I'm like, that's what you're made of. So it's not really a problem. You're made of baryons. But in any case, you ought to have anti-baryons. If the entire universe came, if all the matter in the universe came from energy, you'd have an equal amount of antimatter. And we don't. Our universe is essentially matter only. There's only trace amounts of antimatter that are always produced locally by high energy reactions and then almost immediately destroyed because whenever antimatter comes in contact with ordinary matter, they destroy each other and release energy, electromagnetic energy, and so on. So it's very good that God made the universe matter only. That's a design feature. We don't want equal amounts of antimatter. Thank you, Lord, for doing it this way so that we can be here having this conversation. This is the mature galaxies. The existence of fully formed galaxies was really a surprise from the Big Bang perspective, because in the Big Bang view, I remember when the Hubble Deep Field came out, eventually the Hubble Ultra Deep Field and so on, and I remember the secular astronomers going, that we were not expecting that. Because you see, in their view, you're looking out, you're looking back in time. It's not really true, but for the sake of argument, let's assume that. And so you'd say, you ought to be looking back toward the Big Bang, you ought to see galaxies just starting to form. That's not what we see. We see fully designed galaxies, some of them spiral galaxies that look a lot like the galaxies nearby, as if they were just spoken into existence. And of course, they were. There's the problem of population 3 stars. Stars that we observe in the universe are population 1 or population 2. That refers to the amount of heavy elements that they have in them. In astronomy, any element heavier than helium is referred to as a metal. So we use a different definition in the chemists for metals. So stars, all stars have metals in them. Their stars are mostly hydrogen and helium gas. Okay, those are the two elements that are supposed to be produced in abundance in the Big Bang. And then, but all stars have the heavier elements. They have a little bit of oxygen and a little bit of carbon. And the population 2 stars might have 1,000 times more than that. It's still trace amounts, but here's the problem. The Big Bang, remember, is only supposed to produce what? Hydrogen, helium, a little bit of lithium. Therefore, what would the first stars have to be made of? Hydrogen, helium, a little bit of lithium, right? They can't have the heavier stuff because it takes stars to make that heavier stuff. And therefore, the oldest stars in the universe, which some of which would still be around today, I mean, we find red dwarf stars that could theoretically last the age of, you know, even the 13.8 billion years, supposedly. And yet, all of these stars that we've measured do have some metals in them. They might have very few, but they have some. And that's a problem in a secular view. So there's scientific evidence that challenges the standard cosmological model that has not been resolved in my mind. There are observations that are consistent with the young universe. And this would seem to be a problem because the standard cosmological model requires millions of years. How do we argue, though, for a young universe? Because the fact is, when you do science, observational science, testable, repeatable science in a laboratory, you really can't measure age. Right? I mean, age is not a substance that you can measure. It's not like you can take a rock and scan it with your tricorder and it just gives you the age, you know, measures the ageicles or something and tells you the age. It doesn't work that way. The fact is, scientists make certain assumptions about how things change over time. They make certain assumptions about what things were like to begin with, and then they observe the way things are now, and they draw a conclusion about how old something is. And so my point is that depending on our understanding of history, we're going to draw very different conclusions about the very same evidence. If we accept the secular timescale, the secular way of thinking about things, then there are certain presuppositions that go along with that. Certain assumptions about the past. Secularists tend to believe in uniformitarianism, the idea that rates and conditions have basically more or less been the same throughout history, especially Earth history, but would apply in the universe as well. And so the way something was in the past, we assume, is sort of like it is today in terms of rates and conditions. Whereas in the biblical time scale, we would say, well, we know there have been at least one or more catastrophes, at least in Earth's past. There's the fall, which affected all creation. We don't know exactly how that affected the universe. We know on Earth it brought about thorns and thistles and things like that. And then, of course, on the Earth we have the catastrophe of Noah's flood, which is responsible for much of the geology that we see on Earth today. So very different. And, of course, it happens very, very fast. And then the secularists would tend to assume naturalism, that nature's all there is, that everything is explainable in terms of natural law, whereas I'm a supernaturalist in that I believe that God can do what he wants. I do believe in natural laws because I believe God upholds the universe in a consistent way most of the time. But I also believe God is not bound by natural law. He doesn't have to do it that way. And on some occasions, he seems to suspend natural law for his own purposes. I was reading up a secular criticism of the ICC. One of the guys said that, you know, well, they believe that the origin of the universe doesn't have to be explained by the current properties of the universe. And he said that as if, well, that was just a refutation. You know, like, well, that's just silly. And I'm thinking, why? Well, that's a philosophical assumption on his part. There's no reason why the origin of the universe would have to be explainable in terms of present processes in the universe. The origin of a car is not explainable by the operations within the car, is it? Right? And so there's no reason why the universe would have to be that way. But that's a presupposition. And then based on those presuppositions, you draw different conclusions. You look at your rock, you assume uniformitarianism and naturalism, you say you have billions of years. You might look at the same rock, you assume worldwide flood, you assume a supernatural creation to begin with, you say, well, yeah, creation in 6 days, a few thousand years ago. So the problem is, not with the evidence. We look at the same evidence and we draw very different conclusions about what it means because of our different presuppositions. And so the secularists very consistently will assume uniformitarianism, assume naturalism, and they'll say, how can you not believe in billions of years? And then we look at them and we say, but we know there was a worldwide flood, we know God supernaturally made the universe. How could you not believe in creation in 6 days? How do we get anywhere? Scientifically, the only rational way to resolve a worldview debate, and this is a worldview debate, it's about a debate about different presuppositions. The only way to resolve it is with an internal critique. An internal critique is where you hypothetically assume the starting presuppositions of your opponent and show that they lead to a contradiction. Okay? And it's very powerful because what you're going to do is you're going to say, although I don't believe in uniformitarianism, I'm going to temporarily assume it and show that it leads to an inconsistency. So, Mr. Evolutionist, I'm going to temporarily assume uniformitarianism. I'm going to temporarily assume naturalism and show that in many cases you actually get an age that is inconsistent with billions of years. And you can't say I've made faulty assumptions because I've assumed your assumptions. And so why it's so powerful. And in fact, most of the arguments that you've seen, scientific arguments for a young Earth or a young universe, are along these lines. And so I'm suggesting that we've been doing a pretty good job of arguing this way. However, most people don't understand that. And so we need to do a better job of articulating what we're doing. I've had a lot of people say that, the recession of the moon argument, you assumed uniformitarianism. Yes, that's the point. I assumed your assumption, and it still gave an age that is wrong by your view. Okay, that's the way we need to argue that. Now, if the old earthers were consistent, if they were rational, and they wanted to argue against us, what should they do? They should assume this. They should assume catastrophism. They should assume supernaturalism and show that it leads to a result that's inconsistent with creation in 6 days. Is that what they do? No. They assume this and this and show many instances where it gives an answer they like, which is not rational. I will concede that in many cases, if you make this wrong assumption and you make that wrong assumption, you're going to get a wrong answer. I will concede that. But I don't agree with those assumptions. I think it's interesting that my older colleagues, they're really not being very logical when it comes to argumentation. They don't seem to understand that they haven't really proved what they think they've proved. So what I'm going to do is, for the sake of argument, assume these, and we'll find that, for example, the recession of the moon is a good argument for a young least a young Earth moon system, right? Because the moon is moving away due to tidal forces. It moves away about an inch and a half a year. And we'd expect that on the basis of physics, because the moon induces tides on the Earth. The tides get ahead of the moon because the Earth rotates faster than the moon orbits. They pull ahead of the moon and moves it out. And if you run the equation backwards, and you have to do it right, because if you think about it, when the moon's closer to the Earth, the tides would be bigger, wouldn't it? Because the gravity would be stronger. And so it would go even faster, and they get bigger and go even faster, and so on. You have to use calculus to do it right. The relationship is 1 over r to the 6th power. That's the rate at which the moon moves out. And so when you integrate that, assuming the tidal breaking constant has always been constant, that's the uniformitarian assumption. Not that the rate's constant, but that the rate of the rate is constant, if you will. And then when you run it back, you find that the Earth and Moon would have been in a collision less than 1.5 billion years ago. And again, I'm not suggesting this is the true age of the Earth-Moon system. It's an upper limit, because you can't have less distance than no distance, right? That's the absolute upper limit. And this is a problem because, of course, in the secular view, the Earth and Moon system are supposed to be 4.5 billion years old. And yet, the physics, even given their assumptions, the physics shows they can't be more than 1.5 billion years old, which is less than 4.5 billion years old. It's easy enough even the Common Core folks understand that one. So that's a good one to use. Spiral galaxy wrapping. Spiral galaxies actually rotate faster on the insides than on the outsides in terms of their angular velocity. So a star on the inside of this galaxy will make a loop in less time than a star on the outside of the galaxy. Okay? And we've actually measured that in the Whirlpool Galaxy. That's an actual data plot of the velocities of the stars, because the Whirlpool Galaxy, it looks like it's face on, but it's actually tilted a little bit. And so from the Doppler shifts of the stars, we can measure that. And we know how fast they're moving. We know that. And so I thought, how long would it take for this thing to twist itself up beyond recognition? And the answer is it doesn't take very long. So I took those velocities, which have been measured, put them in a computer simulation. There's what happens. This is based on the actual velocities of the stars in the Whirlpool Galaxy. We're at about 100 million years now. Now, in the secular view, galaxies are supposed to be 10 billion years old. I only ran the simulation out to 1 billion years because there was no point in going beyond that. You see what happens? The galaxy very quickly, by the time you're even a few hundred million years into it, the galaxy is twisted beyond what we see in any galaxy anywhere in the universe. There are no galaxies that look like that I'm aware of. I've seen a lot of galaxies. None of them look like that. They're not twisted that much. They're twisted a little bit. I think that God created the galaxies with spiral arms already. There's a lot of spirals in nature. There's even spiral in mathematics. If you've seen my presentations on the Mandelbrot sets, built into math, they're already spiral. So God created the galaxies with spiral. They've spiraled a little bit since creation. Now, I think your colleagues are aware of this, by the way. There's no disputing that these arms would wrap themselves up beyond recognition in far less than 10 billion years. There's no disputing that. And so the latest idea is, well, maybe density waves create new ones. And so as the old spiral arms disintegrate, new ones are created by pressure waves that come through and trigger star formation. And that's pretty clever. But there's some problems with that. For one, it assumes star formation, of which I'm very skeptical. Again, we've never seen that. So they're relying on something that's not been demonstrated scientifically. But there's another problem as well. You see, if the actual arms had twisted up, that means the material would be wound up, and then the pressure waves would make the new material. But then the magnetic fields would cancel out, because you see, the magnetic fields happen to trace the spiral arms. Now, the thing you need to know is magnetic fields have to move with the plasma. Plasma cannot move across a magnetic field line. And so if it was density waves, you would not see that. That shows that it's the actual material that's being dragged along in that direction. So I think that's very compelling evidence against density waves. And there are problems with what would start them anyway. So the bottom line is, if the universe is 6,000 years old, you'd expect galaxies would look like that. If it was even 1 billion years old, you'd expect the galaxies would look like that. What do galaxies look like? Like that. Consistent with creation, isn't it? We have the internal heat of the giant planets. Jupiter actually gives off twice as much energy as it receives from the sun. Thermal energy is taking in one unit, giving away two, and so on, which means it's constantly losing thermal energy. The problem is even worse with Neptune. Neptune gives off about 2.6 times as much energy as it receives from the sun, which means it's constantly losing energy to space. And if it's 6,000 years old, it just hasn't run out of energy yet, because it's pretty big. I mean, Neptune's four times the size of the Earth. And so in 6,000 years, it's lost some energy, but it's still pretty warm. It's 72 kelvins, which for its distance from the sun is quite warm. If it were billions of years old, it should have lost all of that internal energy, should be gone, and the equilibrium temperature should be 58 kelvins at that distance. What do we find? We find it's 72 kelvins. It's consistent with 6,000 years. Isn't that interesting? Magnetic fields are very consistent with a young solar system. And so we find, for example, that the Earth's magnetic field has been decaying. We'd expect that. Magnetic fields are caused by electrical current, right? You can take, maybe when you were a kid, you took a little coil of wire like that and stuck it to a battery. You can make a little electromagnet that way. And electricity encounters resistance. It runs down. And so Earth's magnetic field has been decaying over time. We've been able to measure that for almost two centuries. It appears to be an exponential decay. That's what we'd expect just on first physics principles. The half-life is something like 1,400 years. There's a few other estimates of that. But you run it backwards, you find that creation is 20 times stronger. That's okay. That'd be kind of nice. You get increased protection from cosmic rays. That'd be kind of nice. Your compass will work better. Neat. But if you run it back 50,000 years, the Earth's magnetic field would have been 56 billion times stronger than it is today. And you don't want that. In fact, if you go back another 10,000 years to 60,000 years, the Earth's magnetic field will be stronger than that of a neutron star. So, you don't want that. It's going to rip the atoms of your body apart. That's not what we want. And this is not, we're not into the millions of years here. We're just, just 50,000 years ago. That's nothing in the secular timeline, right? That's a problem. And it's not just a problem for the Earth. It'd be a problem for the other planets as well. Jupiter has an enormous magnetic field, bigger than the Sun, if you could see it. It's very, very powerful. The planets Uranus and Neptune have magnetic fields consistent with their biblical age of thousands of years. In fact, Dr. Russ Humphreys, who is here today, he actually predicted the magnetic fields of these planets based on their biblical age of about 6,000 years. He said that the magnetic field of Uranus, for example, ought to be in between the light blue line you see it, or the dark blue line up there. It ought to be in between those two limits. It's a logarithmic scale. And it, in a secular view, it really ought to be non-existent. And so when Voyager 2 went through and measured the magnetic field, it was consistent with the prediction. So that's pretty neat. That's pretty neat. Likewise with Neptune. They would not have strong magnetic fields if they were billions of years old. And my secular colleagues say, well, there's some kind of recharging mechanism, the dynamo that recharges the magnetic fields. All kinds of problems with that model. It's never been demonstrated that can actually recharge a magnetic field. And it would require, by the way, the rotation axis to be lined up with the magnetic axis, which is not for Uranus and Neptune. They're not even close. Comets are an indication of thousands of years. We've got comets that orbit the Sun. They're made of icy material, ice and dirt. They orbit the Sun in elliptical paths. When far away, when they come close, that icy material is blasted away into space, forming a comet's tail. So every time you see a comet, it's losing mass, it's getting smaller, they can't last billions of years or they'd be gone by now. We think a typical comet could last something around 100,000 years. Because we know the amount of material that's there. We can measure the rate at which is being depleted. We can do the math. And it's consistent with thousands of years. Some comets even less than that. I've seen comets that have gone behind the Sun and have been totally destroyed in one pass. I've seen comets that no longer exist. So they don't last billions or billions of years. Okay. And again, there's no question about this. My secular colleagues would agree with that. They would understand that comets can't last that long. And so they say, well, there's an Oort cloud that makes new ones. After John Oort, the guy who came up with the idea, says that perhaps there is a big comet generator out beyond the farthest planets where we can't see it. And so the idea is that there are just trillions of potential comets that are orbiting. They're kind of in a circular orbit, so they stay frozen, you see. And then they fall into the inner solar system and become brand new comets. Pretty neat. So as the old ones go away, the new ones replace them. Of course, there's no evidence for Oort cloud in our solar system. And even if we did find it, by the way, there's no known way to make it. At least not one that has the amount of mass that's necessary. Jupiter's supposed to fling out comets into the Oort cloud in the early solar system, but it can only get about one-tenth the amount that would be needed to explain the comet problem, interestingly. So the bottom line is if the solar system's thousands of years old, you'd expect to see comets. If it were really 4.5 billion years old, you'd not see comets, right? And what do we see? Comets. It's consistent with what we'd expect. Blue stars are the hottest, bluest stars. They can't last tens of millions of years. They can't. Blue stars, they tend to have the most mass. They're the most massive stars out there. So they have a lot of fuel available, but they use it up really quickly. They're kind of like the SUV of the star world, right? They have a big gas tank, but they get very poor gas mileage, so they can't go very far in time, and they run out of fuel quickly. And again, the hottest ones, order of a million years or so, the very hottest ones, the O5 type stars, they just can't last that long. And we find them everywhere. We find them all over the stars of Orion's belt, at least two out of three of them are O-type stars. They're all blue stars. And that's a problem. A billion years, my secondary colleagues won't even argue that. They know that they can't last that long. They can do the same math I can do. And so they see, obviously, new blue stars have formed over time. I call bluff. I say, no, we haven't seen that. We haven't. In fact, it turns out the hardest star to make is a blue star. Interesting, because they require the most mass. They'd be the least likely star to form under naturalistic conditions. I'm not going to say it's absolutely impossible for a star to form, but we've never seen it happen, and it seems very unlikely. The conditions in space, normal gas pressure is much greater than the force of gravity in a typical nebula, and so they would not tend to want to contract on itself. And we've never observed that. So the bottom line is, if the universe is 6,000 years old, you have blue stars and red stars, because God can make red stars too. Now, they have the ability to last a long time. That doesn't make them old. It just means they can last a long time. So we'd expect those as well. But if the universe were billions of years old, you'd only have the red stars. What do we have? Blue and red. It's interesting to me that people will say, but, you're a creationist, Dr. Lyle, but how can you're an astronomer, you look at the universe, how can you believe in creation when the universe looks so old? I'm thinking, I don't know what universe you're looking at, but the one I look at in my telescope, it looks young. There's a lot of indications like it. It's not 13.8 billion years old. What about the distant starlight problem? Well, we've heard a number of presentations on that at this conference, and I've got my own version, and I can only, in good conscience, defend the one that I think is most likely to be right. I don't claim any kind of infallibility on it, but that we have an explanation that's consistent with the laws of physics, and it makes sense scripturally as well. And the problem is it's tough to explain to people because we have our way of thinking about time isn't necessarily correct, and that requires some explanation. One way of visualizing space and time is with the Minkowski diagram. We saw one of those in one of the other presentations today, actually, or was it yesterday? Anyway, what this does is it allows us to see space and time sort of all at once, but in order to do that, we have to sacrifice a couple dimensions of space, because we have a two-dimensional screen here, right? So I can only represent two dimensions. So if it's one dimension of time, that'll be on the vertical axis. One dimension of space, that'll be on the horizontal. So that's the Minkowski diagram. And so T is time. And we multiply it by C, the speed of light, so the units are the same. That way we can deal with meters. And that's a conversion factor there. So the x-axis represents space. And so the origin here is Earth. That's where we're at. We're right here. I hope you're here, right? And then these points would represent places very, very far away, perhaps billions of light years away. I could represent distant galaxies, for example, along the x-axis. And then the future would be up there. Just by convention, we put it up. You could do it the other way. It doesn't matter. And then we put the past down there. And so we think of ourselves sort of as going up along that line. That's our world line. And then now is right there. So this is right here, right now. That's far away. That's future. That's past. Easy. And usually the way we portray light on this is with a 45-degree path. And so if I were to turn a light bulb on right now, the light rays would go out like that. They would form two rays, because if you think about it, the light, as it moves forward in time, it moves farther away in space. And so it's going to go, this could be north and south, right? North here. So one of the beams is going to go north, one of the beams is going to go south. Of course, you got beams going east, west, and so on, but we can't depict those on the two-dimensional screen. So if you did, it would form a cone. If you added one more dimension, it would form a cone, right? And then these would represent incoming light from, say, a distant galaxy that's just reaching our eyes right now. When I'm looking at a telescope, those are the light beams I'm seeing as I'm looking at a galaxy. And so there you go. Those are light cones. And they're very helpful in terms of physics of Einstein, thinking about right situations to understand light cones and how they divide space. Now, normally what we would say is, we know this is now right here, that's easy. How do you define now for a point far away? And the way we normally think about it, at least physicists would normally think about it, we'd say, what's the x-axis, right? That makes sense. So this is everywhere along this line is now. Okay, this is now here, this is now very far away north, that's now very far away south. And that makes sense, and that divides the light cones in half, so the outgoing beam looks like it's got the same speed as the incoming beam. That's kind of nice. That makes sense. That's a reasonable thing to do. And so this, for example, would represent a galaxy, as it is right now, that's very, very far away. Yes? This would represent, in the distant future, a galaxy far, far away. This would represent a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. So Star Wars must be within our past light cone, as we know about it. It's interesting, too, because this divides space into sort of sections that are meaningful in terms of information transmission. Anything over here outside the light cones, we can't know about it. And we can't influence it. We might eventually know about it because we're moving up, right? Eventually our past light cone will intersect that. But right now we can't know about that. And we can't know about the future other than what God's told us, right? So this cone right here represents everything we can know about other than things where God has whispered in our ear and told us about the future. This cone right here represents things that we can affect. Our choices now can affect the outcome of something right here. We can't affect anything in these quadrants. It's kind of interesting that the light cones divide space, at least in two dimensions like this, space-time, into four quadrants, one of which you can know about, one of which you can affect. Kind of interesting. So no matter how big of a mistake you make, you can only screw up one-fourth of the space-time continuum. It's kind of nice. Now, if we had someone who was moving at very high speed past the Earth right now, his world line will look like that. Yeah. That makes sense, right? Because if he's moving past the Earth right now, in the positive X direction, that means in the past he was at negative X, so the past he was down there. And in the future he's at positive X. That makes sense. And if you think about it, that's his time axis. Because as far as he's concerned, he's in a spaceship, he's just coasting past the Earth at high speed. I mean, it makes sense for you to almost be your own origin, right? Because no matter where you go, there you are. So, right? So there. So he says, I'm always right here. I'm stationary, and the Earth is moving past me in the negative X direction. So that's his timeline. And there's a way to convert, by the way, coordinates in space and time from my system to his and vice versa. That's not a problem. That transformation is called the Lorentz transformation. That's how you would convert between those two. It turns out not only is his time axis tilted relative to ours, but his x-axis, his space axis, is also tilted relative to ours, like that. And you run through the details on why that is, but when you run through the Lorentz transformation, that's what pops out. Are you hearing me okay? Alright, so this is what's interesting to me. If he's using the same definition of now, we decided now would be exactly between those two light cones, right? Right there, our x-axis. If he's doing the same thing, he's saying, well, speed of light's the same in all directions, and that defines now, that then his now will actually be there. Isn't that interesting? Whereas my now is there. Now, this is kind of fascinating. So an event right here, let's say an event happens right here. Now, again, we can't know about it, because not only is it in the future, but it's in this section of space-time that we can't know about, because the light hasn't reached us yet. But let's say that God whispered in our ear and told us there was going to be a supernova right here. This guy would say it's happening. This guy would say it's happening right now. We're both on Earth. He's passing the Earth. He would say the event's happening right now. We would say it's in the future. Isn't that interesting? Conversely, if, let's say a supernova happens right here, and God tells us about it. He says there's a supernova happening right now in this distant galaxy. You won't see it until the light eventually reaches you, but trust me, it's there. And from his point of view, it would actually be in the past. It already happened a long time ago. And by the way, the difference between these can be enormous. It can be thousands of years easily. And you say, well, that's not a problem because we're all on the same planet. We're all stationary. I got news for you. We're on a rotating planet. You're on a rotating planet, which means the Australians have a very different velocity than you have. At least they have the same speed, but they're in a different direction. And so now for North America is different for Australia. And the difference can be enormous. As you go deeper in space, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It's negligible for the solar system. But as you go into deep space, isn't that wild? And so my point is there isn't an objective now in terms of how the laws of physics work. We can't distinguish. You're tempted to say, which one's the real now? I had somebody ask me that one time. It says, Dr. Lowe, which, you know, if I get to the star right now, what would I actually see? I said, it depends on your definition of now. Are you doing this definition or that one? In fact, anything in between these two light cones is eligible for now, depending on how you're moving. Isn't that wild? Now, we'd all agree the sky who's moving past us, and everyone on Earth will agree that's the future, that's the past. Everything in life, we agree on those. Those are time-like events. There's no disputing that. He said, but wait a minute, our definition now is the right one because we bisected the light cones. The incoming light's the same as the outgoing. But in fact, he's done the same thing. And in his coordinate system, this is what it looks like. From his point of view, he's bisected the light cones, and he would say, this is now, and that point that you thought was now is actually a long time ago. It's nuts, right? Well, this is what you get from special relativity. We may have to go into general relativity. This is what you find. This is called the relativity of simultaneity. It's something that Einstein wrote about very early on in his premier book on relativity. He writes about this. And his solution was just to say, well, there's no objective now. You can do that, and that works in terms of physics. But could we come up with a different definition of now that everyone on Earth would agree on? The answer is yes, you can. But it's not going to be one of these two lines, because those are, you have different velocities, you're going to do that. The way to do it, about like this. Everything within this cone is future, and there's no doubt about that. Everything within this cone is past, and there's no doubt about that. Everything in between them is potentially now, depending on how you define now and distance. And again, now right here, that's trivial. We all know what that is. You look at your watch, I'll tell you now. But is there a definition of now that everyone would agree on planet Earth? The answer is yes. If you do this, if you make the now sort of line up with the past light cone. It's kind of interesting. And why would you do that? Well, two reasons. One, it doesn't matter how you move, okay? Because it turns out motion doesn't affect the light cones. And so if you put the surface of simultaneity on that past light cone, everyone on Earth would agree on it, no matter how they're moving. Interesting. And secondly, this is the way all ancient cultures implicitly did it. Okay, because they're not thinking, when they're seeing an event in space, if they see a star explode, they would say that happens now. And that makes sense, doesn't it? It's only because of we've been trained to think that you're looking back in time, so I wonder when that really happened. But in fact, that's not the normal way to think about things. If you see a deer on the side of a hill, you say, that's nice, I wonder how many millions of years ago that actually happened. It's kind of an unnatural way of thinking about things, isn't it? We do that with space, but in ancient time they didn't. They would have used that definition of now as it goes out in space. They say, "Well, I want it to be perpendicular to my time coordinate." We can do that. You just expand and contract the light cones. You can do that, and that's called an anisotropic synchrony convention. I haven't had come up with different ways of explaining it. I don't know if this is helpful, but this is one way to look at it. And this is not something that a crazy creationist like myself came up with. Actually, Einstein himself wrote about different synchrony conventions, but in this particular convention, Sarkar and Satchel wrote about it back in 99, and they're not creationists. One of them is an ardent evolutionist. He hates creationists. But they pointed out the advantages of using the past light cone as the surface of now in physics, and so it's interesting. I'm not saying the other definition is wrong. I'm just saying it's not the one the Bible uses. I think the Bible uses this definition because this is the one that would be understood by all ancient cultures. And you can see it totally eliminates the star-like problem, doesn't it? Because every event that happens, the light reaches us immediately. And so even today, if you use that convention, you're looking at space in real time, which is quite fascinating. So that's the model that I'm putting out there, and you can take it or leave it, but there it is. So observations really are consistent with the young universe, and including light travel time. That's consistent with the young universe. And there are other ways to do it. You've seen some of those presented at this great conference. And fifth, and this is really important, biblical creation is the foundation of science. It really is. And therefore, any success of science is a proof of biblical creation. Biblical creation is a prerequisite for science. You know what a prerequisite is? You have to take one class in order to understand the next. Science is like that. In order for science to work, the universe would have to be a certain way. It would have to be logical. It would have to be self-consistent. There would have to be patterns to discover. Science is all about finding patterns in nature. That would be a difficult task if there were no patterns in nature, right? And yet, biblical creation makes sense of that. There are patterns in nature because nature is the creation of God, and it's compelled by his mind. So, of course, it's going to be logical and consistent. God's mind is logical and self-consistent. God does not deny himself, the Bible says. So there will be no contradictions in reality. And so Therefore, if science is possible, the biblical creation must be true. And one principle in particular that I want to focus on is the principle of uniformity in nature, not to be confused with uniformitarianism. Uniformitarianism, rates and conditions have always been constant. I reject that because there was a worldwide flood. But I do believe in uniformity, which just means you might think of it as the laws of nature don't arbitrarily change. Granted, God can temporarily change things and do a miracle, but that's rare by definition. Normally, the universe operates in a law-like fashion. And that makes sense because there's a lawgiver. All technology is based on that principle. Your car presupposes that the laws of physics and chemistry will continue to work in the futures that happened past. Right? There's that underlying uniformity. And that makes sense. Laws of nature are consistent over time and space. Why? Because God is beyond time. He can step into time, but he's not limited by it like we are. He doesn't change with time, right? He says, I, the Lord, do not change, therefore you sons of Jacob are not consumed. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so because God is beyond time, he declares the end from the beginning. We know that laws of nature are not going to change because laws of nature are just what God normally does. Okay? They're not going to just arbitrarily change. So the future is like the past in that respect. Not saying the conditions are the same. It might rain on Friday when it's sunny on Wednesday, but gravity works the same on Friday as it does on Wednesday. The laws are the same. And you all assume that. You didn't wake up this morning and brace yourself just in case gravity should send you hurtling toward the ceiling. That would be unusual. But you see in a chance universe, wouldn't it? You ever stub your toe? No mind, you have to get a drink of water, you stub your toe. Ah. Well, the next time you get up to get a drink of water, you say, I'm not going to stub my toe this time. I'm going to turn on the lights this time. I'm going to take it extra careful. Because you assume that if you stub your toe again, it will hurt again. And if you're a Christian, that makes sense. God has promised to uphold the universe in a consistent way. But you see, my point is, an evolutionary chance universe, maybe the next time I stub my toe, it'll be the most enjoyable experience of my life. I'm looking forward to that. Uniformity is only defensible in a biblical creation worldview. We know that because we have a promise from God. God has promised that the basic cycles of nature, the seasons, for example, the day and night cycle, that they will remain as long as the earth does. Now, when judgment day comes, all bets are off. But until then, we can count on the fact that the sun will rise tomorrow. We have a promise from God. And God knows the future, so he's in a position to tell us, isn't he? You see, the Big Bang supporter has no basis for uniformity in nature. Now, he assumes it. Everybody does. It's built into us. Babies know about uniformity in nature. God built that into them. They burn their hand on a candle, they don't touch the candle again. Because they assume it'll hurt again. Isn't that interesting? That God has built some knowledge even in the babies. I think that's fascinating. Yet every step you take presupposes uniformity of nature. You're assuming that momentum and gravity will continue to work as they have in the past. And I would argue we have no right to assume that apart from biblical revelation. Because we can't know the future. Oh, granted, we can know the past because we can remember that. And even there, I'm being generous because I'm assuming your memory operates correctly and so on. But you get my point. Oh, granted, we can know about the present through our sensory experiences. And of course, even there, I'm being generous because I'm assuming that your senses work properly, having been designed by God. That's a creation's principle, too. But you can't know the future. And yet, somehow, we're able to live in this world as we continually. At least in terms of our perceptions, we move forward in time, right? We're able to survive. You know when to bring an umbrella with you, right? We can make predictions about the future. I can tell you that Mars is going to be really bright the next time you look up and see it. Why? Because God has told me something about the future, and God does have knowledge of the future. God's knowledge extends in both directions, right? He knows everything that's knowable. So God knows the future. He's told me he's going to uphold it in a consistent fashion, and so I can count on that. And I can do science because of the promise of God. Secularists can do science because of the promise of God, and yet they don't give him glory or are thankful for that. They suppress the truth and unrighteousness. What are some, you say, is it really that simple? It is, and this is powerful, folks. You may think, well, that's kind of philosophical. This is very powerful because if you get this, you realize any scientific evidence that anyone presents is a proof of a Christian worldview, of biblical creation. What are some possible responses? Some people, you don't need to be a Christian to know about uniformity of nature. Everyone knows uniformity of nature. Everyone knows that because God's placed that knowledge in us. Even babies know that. But my question is, how can you account for it? That's my question. How do you know that the future will be like the past. So, well, do you deny that? No, I have a promise from God. I believe the future will be like the past. But why are you relying on the promise of God while denying the God who made the promise? See? Everybody knows that. Well, then it should be very easy for you to give me an explanation for why. The inherent properties of matter cause it to behave that way. It's just that's the way matter behaves. That's the way Gordon Stein answered this question when it was put to him by Greg Monson, the famous Monson Stein debate. And he said, the scientist said, well, that's the way matter is. Well, first of all, you don't know what the inherent properties of matter are, right? I mean, we study these kinds of things. Secondly, even if you did, you'd only know the way they were in the past. You don't know how they're going to behave in the future. That's the point. But the most common answer you'll get to this, and perhaps some of you are thinking this, when I ask how you know the future will be like the past in terms of basic cycles of nature, let's see, well, always has been. It's always been that way, right? In the past, when we've assumed uniformity, it's worked very well. And so I assume in the future it will work very well. But do you realize that begs the question? Let me see if I can illustrate this. This is tough because we are so used to assuming the future will be like the past that we tend to rely on that even when we're trying to defend it, which begs the question, you see. Whenever we use past experience as a basis for what is likely to happen in the future, we're assuming that the future will be like the past. And so when I ask you, but how do you know that the future will be like the past? You say, well, because in the past it was my past experience. You're assuming the future will be like the past. You can illustrate it like this. Follow me through this one here. Here we have the past, which we remember, okay? And in the past, the future was like the past, right? Past futures were like past pasts. And we know that because that's now all in the past. Yes? And so then he says, I know there's been uniformity in the past. Therefore, I expect in the future will be like the past. But when he says therefore, what's he assuming? That the future will be like the past. The very question I'm asking him to defend. And this occurred to me, it took me a while to get this, so if you don't get this right away, you'll wake up at midnight and go, oh yeah, I got it. This is powerful. By the way, the textbook Kopi and Cohen, which I recommend, their introduction to logic, and their example, begging the question, this is the example they use. And keen minds have been snared by this. But other keen minds have realized this is a problem. The secular philosopher David Hume was utterly stumped on this problem. He could not give the epistemological justification for why the sun would rise tomorrow. He believed it would, but he could not, on his secular worldview, he could not give any logical reason to believe it. It made him so frustrated, he said, I just want to give up philosophy and go play games with my friends. Yeah. Powerful. Biblical creation, we can know about the future because God's told us he'll uphold it in a consistent way. So we can count on the cycles of nature in the future as they happen in the past. Yes, the sun rises tomorrow. And I know that because of the promise of God. And he's beyond time. So we've seen that the standard cosmological model is not a good science. It's not compatible with God. There's scientific evidence that challenges it. There are observations that are consistent with the young universe. And biblical creation is the foundation for science. In fact, that science is possible as a proof of the Christian worldview. We do have some resources I encourage you to get. We didn't bring all of our resources from the Biblical Science Institute. We brought some of our newer ones. I have a book called The Physics of Einstein. Oh, this is for you guys, because I got to tell you, I do a lot of presentations at churches, and I have to say, now this is a little bit more technical than most of my stuff, but you guys are going to love this one. This is for my fellow nerds here, which most of you are, I think. So, and you're the uber nerds because you stayed for the last session, so that's great. Yeah. And so this is going to take you through and show you the physics of Einstein from a Christian perspective, and I do a little bit on the starlight issue too, and you can see how that all works out. It's just a fun book. It's about black holes and is time travel possible and things like that. You can take a look in that book, and love one. So check it out. And I have boxes where if you're inclined, you can go through, we'll show you how you derive some of these things mathematically. And if you don't like math, you can just cover that up and skip it, and I won't tell anybody. We have Understanding Genesis. This is the reputation of Hugh Ross. This is where I go through and I take a look at the arguments that Ross tries to make from the scriptures. Now he's changed his approach over the years, so this is very recent. And I think it's a wonderful resource. How do we interpret scripture? And you can know definitively that God really did that in 6 days. There's no doubt about that. Keeping Faith in an Age of Reason answers 420 alleged contradictions in the Bible. The secularists, there's been this list that floats around on the internet of over 400 contradictions in the Bible. How many Christians possibly believe it when there's all these contradictions? I went through each one and found that not one of them is a genuine contradiction. Not when you actually read the text carefully. And in a few cases, you have to go back to the original, but in most cases, I'm just reading the text carefully. So that's a wonderful resource I encourage you to get. Sign up for our free monthly newsletter, and it is a free newsletter. So check that out. It's an electronic newsletter, so make sure you put your email. It only comes in your email. If you don't put an email, you will get nothing, okay? And it is free. We just want to bless you. And it comes out once a month, so sign up for that. Not too many things free in this world, just the salvation and our newsletter. So check us out. Thank you very much. Be happy to take questions.